Delighted to have you here. A lot has happened for us. When we finally had revenue in about 2008, we started to look for a place that was not a basement. And in the early days in that basement, we invited our first customer, which is a famous clandestine service in America, and we had no product, we had no people, so we all kind of gathered around, much like you try to make yourself larger in front of a bear so it doesn't eat you, to prove we had people, and that's how it began. And then when we moved over to Palo Alto, it was a big moment for Palantir, we felt we had arrived because we had built this product, PG, which really did shift the history of the world, but especially in Europe, by reducing terrorism in accordance with civil liberties. And one of the truisms of business is you're really succeeding at the place where no one believes you actually care. So I cared, we cared about data protection, civil liberties, and we went very deep on these issues. And some of those issues, not all of it, are super important for the AIP product that we're delivering. By the way, we launched the product just under 5 months ago, and now we have 150 companies using that product, 50% growth in the last month. And we're changing our go-to-market because we have no resources, away from 12-month pilots to essentially a boot camp where we all roll up our sleeves over 2 days and like, great, we'll show you it working. But both because, quite frankly, we don't have the resources, and we like to humiliate people out there saying they have products. So what better way to do it? We will show you your enterprise working in 2 days. Talk to other people. But the central reason we have had these precursor technologies, ontology, branching, an understanding of what it would mean to interact with algorithms, whether they're normal algorithms of the kind that are used on the battlefield or large language models, was a deep understanding of NLP. How do you ask and answer questions? They're different in this context, but the core issue we had in building that product was how do you unify data sets where part of the data has to remain unknown to either machine learning or to the end user. And those products are not isomorphic. Those questions are not exactly isomorphic to how do you interact with a large language model, which is not exact in a way where you can extract value that needs to be exact under conditions where you, for legal, moral, and ethical reasons, cannot expose, and business survival reasons, your knowledge of the world to a third party's LLM. There's jarringly similar use case, and this is why we have all these people adopting the product, because quite frankly, unless you spent 20 years looking at those, you would make certain mistakes. The text that at the time, because intelligence operatives have to work with things they know are true and data sets that they are hoping are true. And at the time, you really couldn't interact with the text very easily. And so dealing with something has become very, very powerful, but that's not exact, and the kind of exact algorithmic things you would need to make operational decisions to write to your enterprise. It just takes a long time to believe that that's how you have to build it, and longer to build a product. And so I associate Palo Alto with our ascendancy, and this building with our ascendancy, and our commercial business, and quite frankly, our government business, in the United States, with a really cool ride, and then just a kind of obvious addendum. I was just at this gathering organized by Senator Leader Schumer, and there are many things that happened there, but it's very hard to explain how, in reality, if you even took the people who were not in the room and then the people who, like the league below them and the league below them, you would still have a stronger tech community than any other country in the world. It's just actually kind of bonkers. Like, you have any one person on the tech side in that room has a larger tech business than probably any other country besides America. And so we're at this moment where, you know, and we're fighting very hard to get adoption on the battlefield. Some of which is happening, it's a lot of it's sensitive, can't really go into it, but obviously we believe not quickly enough. But one of the things that you are doing, quite frankly, without realizing it, is you're putting pressure on our government to adopt AI in a way that will improve all of our lives with guardrails in the civil context and with guardrails in the military context, simply because you're going to adopt things and you're going to run into senators and congresspeople and generals and colonels and sergeants and healthcare providers and people at the VA and be like, but why is my product better than yours? And this is probably the most, there are many reasons why I'm super happy about the work we're doing in U.S. commercial and quite frankly, the just amazing, I never thought we'd get to the point where the growth was so significant. We are just trying to scrap to figure out how we can do these things. But one of the orthogonal reasons I'm very happy about this is there's no better way to cajole an organization to work faster, in this case our clandestine and military services, than to say, okay, well, you know, you paid $1 billion, you have a jalopy, I paid $5 million, and I'm running my whole organization. So I'm very passionate about this for lots of reasons, but that's also one reason. And I think we have some questions, and try to keep me out of purgatory. I'm already skating a fine line. Luckily, my co-founder, I didn't appreciate the value of, we have these F shares, which basically means it's harder to fire me, but then I go to these meetings and I get away with speaking a plain English because of these F shares, but I'm realizing I'm skirting on thin ice, so maybe, yeah. I don't know, someone's gonna ask a question.
Please welcome Senior Director of Government Services at Cisco, Mike Yonkers.
Morning. Are we gonna sit down or stand up or?
I'm standing, but right. you do you.
It's your show. I'm honored to be here with you today.
It's not my show. It's actually your show, and you want to stand, hop.
I do not want to hop. Thank you. I certainly don't want to dance.
Do a little.
I used to play the drums, and I used to be able to do that sort of thing, but I can't do that anymore. But I do have a question for you, and you've kind of started talking through that already this morning. I work in the government solutions part of Cisco, and I'm fascinated by this kind of government to commercial, commercial to government. I have some history previously with InQtel, and I read Shyam's blogs this past weekend about Palantir government web services, and that's what's enabling what we're working for inside of Cisco. But the thing I'm fascinated by, I'm just fascinated by the company in general. The people here are unbelievable. And I've watched a lot of companies try to bring technology that was built for the government to commercial, and a lot of companies try to bring commercial technology to the government. And I've seen very few companies succeed, and it feels like you guys are succeeding in doing that. I'm curious, like, what is it that, what's the secret? Like, how are you able to do this when so many other companies fail at that?
I appreciate the question. A lot of companies succeeded at this. It's just they haven't succeeded in the last 50 years.
Okay.
So a lot of the innovation, I believe, one of the reasons America was less divided in the past was that you had tech companies that dedicated themselves to building products for the government that then repurposed them for commercial. So then, a reframing the question would be like, why did that stop, and why are we able to do it? And arguably, we're even succeeding more in commercial than we are anywhere else. First of all, we do attract and retain the very best people in the world, and we do that by. It sounds corny, but we are a believer culture, and that believer culture allows us to. Unify under a belief, which, by the way, does exclude people. Like, who, if you don't think the U.S. government should have the best software in the world, if you're uncomfortable with the fact that we supply our software to the battlefield in the U.S. and to allies, we respectfully ask you not to join Palantir. By the way, not in like you're an idiot. It just we have this belief structure. That belief structure allows us to get people. It's like one of these things where the narrowing of the selection leads to a broader ability to deal with different kinds of difficult people. You may know from your organizations, many of the most talented people in the world have one thing in common. They're very difficult. And then that belief, by the way, obviously I'm not, we're not like, it varies day to day, and God knows I've been frustrated by, I get most frustrated by the people I believe in when I feel like, but that, and then I think the secret is if you are really doing something because you believe in it, you are often solving the problem that the customer, call this clandestine services in America or the DOD or somebody, it's not the problem they want to pay you to build. It's the problem you believe they need to solve. Mm. And that's a subtle difference. And the giving them a solution, which unfortunately in our culture is often a long services program, that where the person being paid absorbed no risk, which is one of the reasons why these things often don't work at a cost that's crazy. But the customer is getting what they want. What we're doing is going to a very different level of abstraction and saying, but what is the question that they are asking that's technical? What will be the question that will, is it, you should be asking tomorrow, the next day, in 1,000 days? And can we build something at that level of abstraction? The negative version that we have internally is, since we know that in the beginning we were very unpopular, it's like, how good can the product has to be good enough that even though we're the least popular people in the room, they're still gonna buy it. And that's very deep in our DNA. Like our ugly duckling DNA, it's like a real thing. We believe, now we're not the ugly ducklings anymore, but don't tell us that. Certainly don't tell our people that. Like we need to build products, ugly duckling products, meaning you're going to buy this product despite the fact you do not enjoy being in the room with us because it will save your life. That is, and if you build products like that, and then I'll tell you on the commercial thing, I think what is really resonating, like if you talk to people here, you know, of course, we're a commercial company, you're a commercial company. There are always misalignments. We're much less misaligned with you than I believe any other company you'll ever interact with, because in the end, we want to deliver things that work because we know that that's how we survive. And then because we were so bereft of common sense, we have not played by the, like there's a playbook on how you build these companies. And it's like build thin technology, hire thick sales force, hire CEO that Wall Street loves. Okay. Our product, that doesn't look, that's not us. Right. So everybody, but that's the playbook you play. Everybody, like you go to a venture or any, that's the playbook. So everybody has this one playbook. We have another playbook. And our playbook, it's really hard to get to work. But when it does work, you end up with super loyal reference customers and partners. And they run around saying, yeah, okay, the first meeting may be weird, but you'll see. And then America is also shifted. Like, we're not that outside the norm anymore. But I think that's how we did it. And for us, now I'm very focused on empowering the younger people at Palantir. Yeah. I getting them on the forefront, getting their comp structure and other things to work for them. Rebuilding the company has to be a different company in an LLM AI world. But we must build products that transform the institutions we work with, where we're fully aligned with you succeeding. Yeah. But like in private, if you taped a conversation with us, what you would find is, sure, we have frustrations with X, Y, just like
sure.
you do.
Sure.
Probably.
Yeah.
But
the world's an imperfect place.
Yeah. You're not going to find conversations where we're like, oh, what is this thin bullshit piece of product that we can get a salesperson to buy over a steak dinner that they're going to hate? It's not going to work, and it's going to boost our market cap because our CEO is really good at hanging out with analysts, and the analysts believe something they read at Harvard Business School 50 years ago that no one believes except for them. And then we don't do that. And if you want that, you go somewhere else, and there's lots of opportunity for that, and that's just not who we are.
Well, thank you. You said this in my first conference that I was here, and you said iterate with a partner that you can trust, and we trust Palantir, and it's awesome to work with you guys. So I appreciate the spirit and the answer to that question. So thank you.
Thank you.
Please welcome Chief Operating Officer at Cone Health, Mandy Eaton.
By the way, I apologize for the dental music, but you don't have to sit in the chair.
Nice to see you.
Unless you want to.
If I sit, will you sit, or are you going to stand?
Whatever you want.
Let's
prefer
sit.
To sit. Could I have something to drink? Yeah. I'm here. Yeah.
Thank you. I have a couple of questions. One, my first question, thank you for having this conversation. I think this is great. Our industry, healthcare, typically lags in its adoption of technology. And there's a lot of good reasons for that. I'm curious, for those of us who are trying to drive faster adoption, what recommendations do you have for us?
Palantir's doing jarringly well in healthcare, and there's a technical component, and I could there's a lot product market fit, to use jargon, but again, a lot of our DNA, and I'll get you, is like to survive in an unfriendly environment. Like for us in the beginning at Palantir, we had to get users first at clandestine services and then in the military. In the military, these people really know what they're doing. The people, and many are not particularly technical. Mm-hmm. And you can supply the best product in the world as a matter of theory, but if none of them are using it, first of all, it's obviously not valuable. And second of all, the product can't get better because it gets better, and this is before we were doing algorithmic things at scale, really. Product gets better by having more users. More users mean, the cliche is more users mean more data, but what it really means is more insights on top of the data that allow you to understand the parts of the data that are valuable. And now you can do that on steroids. So the most important thing for getting innovation into the hands of the people is getting innovation into the hands of the people. And sitting there, I think the people running our hospital division, for example, have done an amazing job of, like, you've got to engage with the frontline people. What is your actual problem? Here, by the way, like a culture of mutual honesty is crucial, because in all large organizations, there's always, at every level, there's alignment, but there's also misalignments. Mm-hmm. Like, maybe what the special operator wants to tell you is, my biggest impediment to my work is the bonehead officer, right? But, like, how do I build a product where I can do the work and then it feeds up to them, but where they're not in the way of the work? You have all these issues, like, hey, my real problem is not what I'm being told by the corporate people, and I'm going to block adoption unless you solve the problem I care about. But if you identify that problem, you can also go to the people in charge and say, okay, we will get them to adopt this product. We need to build feature sets that get them to use it. And then, because they're using the product, you can also guide the people. And when I say guide, I mostly don't mean control. Like, what the more successful products do is they provide a range. So we did this early on with financial decisions. Like if you're working in a healthcare context, what will get broad adoption is, like, my dad's a doctor. If I tell my dad, hey, Dad, I know how to build a business, he'd be like, well, I read a book, and I'll tell you how to do it. Or something, right? So doctors are doctors. But if you provide a range of, like, okay, well, this is where we think the decision should go, and mm-hmm. you get to iterate, you're empowering the end user. And that range guidance also gives the people who are managing the P&L of the business a lot of ability to control the kind of costs and risks that they're managing. And so what you really, and there's architectural ways in which our product is built for that, mm-hmm. again, because that's how we learn to survive. And also because we don't believe we can survive if you're not using our product. Mm-hmm. But you have to empower the people on the front end in a way where they want to use it, in a way where they still get to make decisions, because there's just some things that are never, like a doctor looks at a patient and will tell, has a feeling, is this patient healthy or not? Mm-hmm. And if you're going to tell the doctor that they can't have that, they're not going to use their product. Same thing for nurses. And so, but you can say, okay, we have capacity issues. And if you make these kind of selections, you will not no longer have the capacity issues. And by the way, the frustrating part of you having to tell people no all day, and that's how you get adoption. And then you build on top of that and you get a very strong product.
That's great. So people are really at the heart of this. And I think that leads me to my second question is, when we think about AI and similar technology, should we be thinking about that as job replacers, job changers, or just efficiency drivers? You know, should AI and other solutions like this be helping us to keep pace with how fast our information uptake has become, or can we do less or simplify things?
I don't think there's one unified answer to this. I think in the healthcare industry, where you have, you're very constrained by the number of people you could hire anyway. The primary focus will be making people who are already doing a good to very good job much more efficient. So increasing the productivity of the workers, and then there are lots of reasons why. So, you know, it's like, you will get a lot more value out of the individual workforce you have. And that there'll be less replacement than people think, but that's also because the delta between what you're being asked to do and what you can do is so large. So like, you know, you're dealing with thin margins, heavy regulatory environment, and increased demand. So even if as we increase your efficiency, it's still gonna be a long time before that's truly efficient. I think in broader society, what you will find is people who are at the nexus of either high training or high training in regulatory context, it will augment. I do think if you're not trained, you will have to be retrained, because the current use of the LLM that's most efficacious is augmenting. It's still augmenting more than people want to acknowledge. It's especially if there's any actual output that matters. So like, you know, it's like moving from poetry to decision requires, you're augmenting the ability of a trained, thoughtful individual more than you are replacing them in the near term. But again, I think this is where you'll see a otherwise constrained environments in the U.S. commercial outperforming other Western societies, because they have the same issues, but they're rejecting the implementation of these technologies either directly or indirectly by making it, you know, most of the great providers are in the U.S., and that's hard for some places to accept.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
Great to see you.
Please welcome from Panasonic Energy, Alex Majewski.
Woo! Morning, Dr. Karp.
Sit, stand.
Sit's good.
Okay.
So I want to ask you more of a philosophical question this morning. So with all of the gloom and doom that's in the media these days around AI, especially in the context of arts and culture, what are some of the positive transformations that you think AI is driving humanity towards that most people aren't thinking about?
Well, I mean, there are some dangers. So, like, there are two camps here in broadly speaking, those that say it's all good and those that say it's all bad. And I think it's kind of pretty good and very good. And then unless it goes all wrong, and then there's a civilization risk.
Yep.
First of all, just, you know, this is probably not the right way to answer the question. I always am my mom's an artist. I grew up around artists. I kind of personally reject, like most people view artists as being painters, photographers, writers. I honestly, I view building a business as an art form. So, you know, like I do think that if you change artists to I want to do a creative endeavor, creative as defined by I'm going to build something that is not the way I would be taught in school to build it, however, deals with the underlying issues of your art. So like you do need to know how to be trained how to paint in order to be a great artist, but then the great painters and writers are almost have extended their art. So if you read, you know, in philosophy, I could give you a long list, but you can tell every single sentence is from this person. And if you change it to the basis of almost everything that we enjoy in this world, certainly in this country, was in the beginning some form of art, like the business that you know you're building, the way in which you're adapting, the people who create the most value, and then you also assume the people who do this are kind of often outside the norm, meaning they don't fit exactly into the current structures, part of the reason they do the art. I tend to see the LLM movement as enormously emancipatory. And I also think that, you know, the thing that's interesting about large language models is they're, like many artists, they are absolutely unique in their capabilities, and then they also can't really go buy a pack of cigarettes or get a coffee off the ground. Like, they don't add well, they hallucinate. Yeah. You know, I think if you approached large language models as they themselves are great artists, as opposed to they're great scientists, you'd have a much better, accurate understanding. And therefore, I think they partner very, very well with creative people who also are very uneven, of which I would definitely include myself, if that's not obvious. But it is obvious to everyone who works at Palantir, believe me. They're like, why is Karp bumping his head, turning the wrong left again, telling us to launch this product? And I think what you will find in a culture, again, okay, so we hire a lot of people from France, interestingly, because France has essentially one school that if you go there, you get to rule France, and if you don't, you don't. Like, you can just see structurally in a country where everyone gets to go to bat, basically, because we don't have one school. I don't know where you went to school. I don't care. No one cares. Yeah. Like, it's not even relevant. Like, yeah. It's like, doesn't matter. I don't know what your parents did. No one cares. Literally, no one cares. It's all this stuff we have to talk about. No one cares. People care about your performance, and are you doing something interesting, and that's basically it. AI will hypercharge people who are doing something unique and interesting, whether it's inside an organization, meaning in a business that exists, building new organizations, transforming. I mean, one of the things I admire about what you guys are doing is you're bringing a hybrid culture of Japanese production to America. Okay, that's much, much easier, I would say probably not possible without software and AI. But then what's gonna make it particularly interesting is it is a hybrid culture. You're bringing certain things that Americans are very pragmatic, creative attitude, but built on top of a way of doing things that is, for what you're doing, arguably the best in the world. But that is a AI creation and action. It really does mean that the value you're creating is pretty much non-attenuated from you in a way that it was in the past. And it's particularly good if you're sitting in this country, which is why, we see it at Palantir, people flooding into Palantir from all over the world because you can just work in your own context. So I think in the near term for many, many, many people that I find inspiring and disproportionately in America, this is going to be a freeing technology. Mm-hmm. And especially for people with artistic proclivities. And so that is one of the reasons why, even personally, I wanted to embrace this earlier than others. And I think it's gonna really make people, with guardrails, obviously, happier and wealthier.
So following up a little bit on what you said around the Japanese and the American culture and bringing us together, the world seems farther apart than ever in my lifetime. So do you see AI and things like LLM really bringing us back together?
You mean the world, America, inside America, or?
The world in total. Seems like there's so many fractions.
I'm gonna leave the American, we are divided, which is an issue, but then maybe we get a lot of growth and suddenly we're less divided. But I don't think on the international stage it's gonna get better. It's gonna get much worse. Hmm. And then that's a separate discussion for, I'm spending a lot of my time meeting with people in DC and cajoling, begging, pleading. There's some 0.2% of the DoD budget, 0.2%. No, I'm not making that up. 0.2% is being spent on what you could call, what they're calling AI. And then what software really depends on who builds it. You need money and you need the right people and you need the right partners. And it's all three components. And of course, America, without going into details, is pretty far ahead on certain elements, but our main adversaries are aware of this, and in my view, and again, no one has to agree with me in this room, but I think you get world peace by US being clearly the strongest nation in the world, because you could argue about our pluses and minuses and faults. I think we spent a lot of time talking about that, but I'm not aware of any other country that is benevolent with great power as the US. Mm. And those of you in this room and others who disagree with it, okay, so I could just narrow it. Our adversaries will be very different than we would be if they had military superiority in AI. So that's a separate issue, but I think that's how you get a more unified world. But if I had to predict, it's gonna be pretty rough. Hmm. But in any case, thank you for these questions.
Yeah.
Really appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Please welcome Telco Managing Partner at DXC, John Boehm.
Dr. Karp, how's it going?
Very firm handshake.
Yeah. Oh, my no notes, perfect. So I've been in and around quite a bit of launching of commercial on Foundry, a handful of different organizations. First time I saw it about 6-7 years ago, one of the big things leadership from Palantir is always saying is, this technology is at least 5 years ahead of our next nearest competitors. Do you still feel like you've got that kind of a gap in between where you are today and other competitors in enterprise SaaS analytics space?
It depends. We have a number of products. Certain aspects of our product, the 5 years ahead is also a euphemism for no one really understands why this works.
Right.
And they haven't started building. Now, I would say, in the AI context, the context of time has shifted. So like people are doing what you would take 10 years in like 2 years or a year. Certain products that aren't relevant for this audience, like PGA, Gaia, Nexus Peering, Apollo, might be like, there's just no one else gonna build them. Then you have Foundry. I don't think anyone's going to build Foundry for lots of reasons. It's expensive, hard to build. It only looks really valuable now. So it was valuable before, but somehow it wasn't in the zeitgeist that how valuable it could be. Foundry until AI was like, it was kind of like a, God bless all of you who adopted it. And I believe it is the best product on the market, but it basically was like a, we will make your enterprise work better, but you're not gonna have any fun. And so, And now it's like, we will get your enterprise sizzling because if you have it, you can adopt AI in an ethical way and change your business. So now it's kind of, for lack of a better word, it's sexy. So there may actually be people who build components of Foundry, and you know, I cannot believe that people are not focused on building like branching, ontology, logic. Everyone's going to need, but you know, one of the things about being kind of, you know, like from the outside, we're not following a playbook. So people are like, well, but where's the playbook aspect of ontology, branching? Where does that fit into my 5, 6, whatever, however they do? So in each one of these cases, we're de facto very far ahead. Mm-hmm. I think the 5-year thing might, you have to compress that because AI, large language models, and copilots, other things will allow you to work quicker and people see the roadmap. And quite frankly, if you're looking at PG, you know, we have, I don't know, a large percent of the addressable market, but no one cares because the market is very small.
Right.
Whereas here, the market is infinite. It's the only market that matters. I'm still somewhat optimistic because we owe a lot to the venture community. I think the venture community is going to have a very hard time in that they want a model where all the money is in building new LLMs. And I believe all the value is in managing the LLM in a safe, effective way and writing logic to it. And that's a subtle difference. If we are right, you want to be a company that's off the ground and has something like we have, existing client base, a reputation, something like Foundry, an ability to implement ontology, understanding of tooling, even the understanding of you would need tools. It sounds very simple.
Right.
And obviously LLM needs tools, but even that is like somehow outside the financing bailiwick of most venture people. And then you have large companies. These companies are the best in the world at what they do, but with notable exceptions, they, in my business, the software business, they're just not that many software engineers. And then it's like, so their model is to acquire companies. Well, and there are not that many companies to acquire. So I'm pretty optimistic about this, but on the other hand, internally, we are running very quickly. You know, we don't want to make the mistake of being ahead and then losing.
Right. So you were saying about the compression of the time frame. So I think that one of the things right now, LLMs are going and accessing human source material. Humans have created that first level of material. And so you can take that 10 years of understanding down to one because all the source material is human generated. How do we prevent, as we layer more AI generated content on top of, you know, out in the, just even in the ecosystem of the internet, how do we keep these AI models from getting dumber by then consuming their own output and then using that in the next training set?
Well, that's a super interesting question. I would say most people are worried about them getting smarter and then making us irrelevant. And I hope we have the dual challenge of that they get dumber and dumber. And then, of course, the way to solve that problem is you need Foundry, you need logic, you need an ontology. But so that would be the answer. There's a real chance that you're right that they get dumber and dumber, but yeah, and again, I think you should maybe explain that problem to the venture community. That's my critique. That's what they're selling. And you know, you'd be surprised. We should not be running around telling people, look, your thing is going to fail. I do it anyway, but partly because no one listens. And it's like, you know, but that is a legitimate and profound critique of what most of the businesses that are being financed here are going to do.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think I may be, is this the time to throw me off the stage?
Please welcome from Cleveland Clinic, Adrian Mew.
Well, huge honor.
Hi. Thanks for having me. You know, my question has to do with your position in AI and what sort of influence you see for patient care and hospital operations?
Well, first of all, it's a great honor. I think you're our first partner in your space.
Yeah. I just want to give a shout out too to Jeremy, Drew, and Pargo. They're great. Yeah.
They are. And their team below them are very. I was in New York and over the weekend and some weird hour, and they're all there. So they're a very special crew. Look, in your space, you have governance issues, you have ethical issues, you have privacy issues. Everybody wants effective care. Nobody wants their personal patient data exposed to anyone. You have very technical users. Technical users will not use a product that tells them that they're not engaged with. So they need to be brought along. Quite frankly, you have legal liability issues. So how do you protect healthcare providers from being randomly sued? Anyone who's got a relative or is involved in healthcare has a somewhat cynical view of how that happens, or realistic view. And then the stakes couldn't be higher. And so the way you implement is you show the end user that this is reliable, it is augmenting their work, it's making their work safer and more effective, and you get them, because only they can tell their peers that this is working, to tell their peers this works. And then it's obviously very helpful when you have, you know, a mission-driven organization like yours, where people, you know, up and down the chain are really engaged in this. I do think in your industry, as I mentioned before, it's you guys are under a lot of pressure because of high regulation, litigious context, and margins that are pressed. And there is no answer for that besides implementing software. It's just that, because you can't change the other variables. And we could debate, you know, if we could change the other variables, that would also be an option. And quite frankly, if I were in charge of that, I would be very open to discussions. But in reality, those are the constraints for now and probably for a long time. And then you have to get proverbially a lot more from less. And that is what Foundry does. That's what AIP does. And that's why our partnerships in this area have gone very well.
Yeah, it has. Can I just add to that? Sort of my philosophy with what I do is to try to be disruptive. Think outside the box. Basically, whatever I see what's being currently done, I want to do the opposite. And so I'm trying to leverage you guys and AI and the technologies. In your position, what would you say is the next step towards operations, how to leverage that AI technology in the hospital industry?
Well, I mean, it's obvious in some ways, identifying people's risk proclivities, having an updated understanding of the literature and the treatment profiles, being able to give the end user the absolute most accurate current understanding mm-hmm. of patient treatment data. We're probably not very far from more individualized or already individualized genetic-based medicine, which is not going to be possible without AI and mm-hmm. broadly defined. And I would say, you know, and a governance structure that protects everyone involved.
Yeah.
Because, you know, you can't do individualized medicine without making an individualized assessment, and that without the right governance structure puts the healthcare provider in a misaligned relationship with the person they're trying to treat. And mm-hmm. there's a banality of healthcare, but it's like you have to have full alignment between patient and doctor. But then you're doing this in a data-rich, regulated environment.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very hard use case.
Yeah.
So thank you for your time.
Thank you.
And welcome to our humble abode, and I hope you learn a lot. We will learn a lot from you, and thanks for coming.